Bernardo Secchi é formado no Politécnico de Milão. Desde 1966, ele é professor de economia do território, inicialmente junto à Faculdade de Economia de Ancona, em seguida no Instituto Universitário de Arquitetura de Veneza. Desde 1974, ele é professor titular de urbanismo junto à Faculdade de Arquitetura de Milão, onde foi diretor junto ao Instituto Universitário de Arquitetura de Veneza. Desde 1986, ele ensina também junto à École d'Architecture de Genebra, Universidade de Leuven, na França, Politécnico Federal de Zurich, na Suíça, o Institut d'Urbanisme de Paris e a École d'Architecture de Bretagne et Rennes, na França. De 1982 a 96, ele colaborou com a revista Casabella e de 84 a 90 dirigiu a revista Urbanística. Entre suas principais publicações, em português, Primeira Lição de Urbanismo e a Cidade do Século XX. Em italiano, Um Projeto pelo Urbanismo, Uma Narrativa Urbanística, O Equilíbrio Territorial e o Desenvolvimento Econômico, Análise Econômica do Problema Territorial e Uma Análise da Estrutura Territorial. Ele redigiu numerosos planos reguladores e planos territoriais, dentre eles Gese, Siena, Centro Histórico de Ascoli Piceno, Bergamo, dentre outros. Com Paula Vigano, fundou em 1990 um estúdio com sede em Milão. Participou do Grand Paris 2008-2009, na sequência no Grand Bruxelas e no Grand Moscou. E hoje ele é aqui nosso conferencista no seminário, professor Bernardo Secchi. We are all yours, the floor is all yours.
Eu quero apenas reiterar as boas-vindas que fazemos todos arquitetos ao nosso prezado colega Bernardo Secchi, com a dimensão maiúscula da sua atividade no exercício do urbanismo, da arquitetura, do magistério, da crítica, da escrita, da política, enfim, uma dimensão múltipla, reconhecida internacionalmente, e para nós é uma honra enorme, um prazer tê-lo conosco nesse seminário Quitandinha Mais 50. Bernardo, muitíssimo obrigado mais uma vez pela sua generosidade de vir de Milão para estar conosco essa noite. Muito obrigado.
Many thanks. It's an honor for me to be here. And when somebody is inviting me in a colloquium like this one, I'm always asking myself, why me? And in the intervention before, I learned so much about Brazil and about the history of Brazil, the theme and the issues, or the main issues you have now in Brazil, that I think that they invited me in order to teach me something. I'm working at a lower level. I mean, the problems that they propose to the debate are in my background, but I'm used to work on problems that I can solve, and I can hope to solve. And so, as you will see, at a lower level. As a matter of fact, in the last 25 years, with Paula Vigano, we prepared projects and plans for many cities in Europe. Don't forget that I'm European. So my experience is in Europe and US. I know I visited many times Brazil, but I don't know Brazil so well to tell something about Brazil. And as you, no, why is not that? As you see, we studied many cities in Europe. Studying is that we prepared some project in order to improve their situation, to solve their main problems, and to understand the different situations. You can see that there are cities very different. Some of them are northern cities, others are from the south. Some are very big metropolis, Paris, Moscow, Brussels. Some others are small cities. Europe is a continent of small cities. It's not. Some of them have a typical institutional framework, others have a lack of institutions that are not working and so on. In these cities we prepared many. Don't worry, I will not show you our project. It's not that this interesting. What I want to say is that this was a long trip in a different situation, a long experience to propose some project to solve some specific problem, and to learn by the reaction we had to our projects, to learn something about the society, about the economy, about the institution in the different cities. For instance, this is a project for the theater plane, the square of the theaters in Antwerp, and we conceived this square as a play where as a site where to stay and to play also, and to have at the market. And the project was successful. People liked it. This site was a site that people in Antwerp discarded, and now they like it. And also, this is a park, a minimal park. That is a park that is not expensive. That we studied a way to do that in a very difficult part of the city of Antwerp. Immigrants of different kinds, conflict between different ethnic conflict and so on. And we try to do something that is very successful. Young couples are going there to marry, or part of that to marry is a mistake, but they are going there, and this is not a mistake. And this is a cemetery, because in the city there are also this, and in a valley. And what was for us important is that you know that is again in Belgium, and Belgium is conceived as a flat country. And when we proposed this project, we told them, be careful, it's not true that it's flat. There are many slopes, very gentle slopes. And what is important for us is that these slopes are very gentle. That is, when I'm on the top, I see the valley, and I have an horizon that is very large. When I in the valley, I have a horizon that is very narrow, and so we consider the cemetery not as usual, the graves, but as a path that is going in the valley, and again something very simple, that is the whole of the ceremonies, very simple with very few materials. And again, this, the Belgian people are a little bit surrealistic, so they help you. But it was a success because you see, it's a cemetery, it's a park, it's a, what is it? I like it very, very much. Then, studying this different situation, these different cities, we learned that they are different, but they have something in common. Something that I will call the new urban question. I have to explain what I mean by urban question and why it is new. Let me start with some banal concept that now are more banal because Alberto Rivera told something about this at a higher level than me. First, many observers are saying that there is, on the planet scale, there is a process of urbanization that is a trend that we cannot stop. It's seriously not probable that we can stop this process of urbanization. It is an important redistribution of the planet population in the different continents, in the different countries, in the different regions, in the different sites. And individual social groups are meeting in a new way. That is, for Europe, is something that could be dramatic because many countries in Europe are not used to have ethnic differences inside them. And I have to remember you that the 20th century was a century in Europe, was a century of ethnic cleaning, dramatically ethnic cleaning. And so this is a problem. The immigration is a very big social problem in Europe because the immigrants have a different cultural background, have a different behaviors and so on. Then the cities in Europe developed in a different periods. Paris was the icon of the 19th century, as London, as Vienna, as Milano too. And Paris is different from all the vertical cities that became the icons of the 20th century, like New York, like Hong Kong, Singapore, and so also São Paulo. And they are different from the dispersed metropolis that is going from Lille to Brussels to Antwerp, Rotterdam, Amsterdam, Cologne. That this immense dispersed metropolis that has the same population as Paris, as London, and the same economy, let's say, is the importance of the economy as Paris and London. My first hypothesis is that all these cities have to face in the next future the same problems. But however, these problems are declining in a different way in each one of these metropolis. There is not only a way to solve their problems, there is a different ways that are specific of future metropolis. I will come back to this point. Many observers are also seeing that the climate change has some consequences that could be very dramatic, and that the increasing CO2 emissions that deriving from the traffic, from production and so on, are very strong, the consequences in the metropolitan areas. So the urban morphologists are responsible of the climate change. On the other hand, we cannot say that the responsible is only the traffic, and we have to take in account that mobility is conceived now in many cities, in many metropolis, as a part of the right to the city, to give accessibility to everyone and to everywhere is considered a right of the city today in many cities, and you will see the consequences in some of the metropolis that we studied. And third point, many observers recognize that the social inequalities are growing also in the wealthiest countries, in the richest countries, mainly in the richest countries, and mainly in the metropolitan area. What is typical of this growing of social inequalities, and that they are now spatially visible, that in our contemporary city, in our contemporary metropolis, rich are on one side and poor on the other side. They are divided. And to study the way in which that was not typical of ancien regime city, and to study this problem is to discover that urbanism has a very important responsibility in creating social differences. So there are many devices that were proposed by us architect and urbanist with a good intention, and but that the effect of which were to increase social inequality and to push a policy of social exclusion or social marginalization. Then for me the urban question is declined on these three themes: environmental problems, mobility problems, and social inequalities problems that are linked together, that cannot be solved separately. You cannot solve the mobility problems as a problem different from social inequalities or different from environment problem. Then the new urban question can be expressed on the basis of growing urbanization and spatial distribution of the population on the world, in terms of climate change and the greater responsibility of the large metropolitan areas, and in terms of social inequalities and the responsibility of urbanism in this. It is not the first time that in the Western history the urban question emerges. It is enough to remember what was called the luxury controversy during the 18th century. Then the first industrial entrepreneur against aristocracy in the city consuming, there in the country producing. And after the well-known the question of housing question at the middle of 19th century, that was the outcome of the passage from a rural industry dispersed in the country and the organized in the factory system industrial production in the cities with the concentration of proletarians in the main. And after the turn of the 20th century, what was called the Großstadt question, that in the emerging of metropolis. The metropolis was the emerging of the code of the mass society, the society that was less and less deemed individualized, that everybody was a part of a class, of a group, homogeneous group. And finally, at the middle of the 20th century, the Ford Taylor system of production was disappearing is not the right term, and society was more and more individualized. The crisis of the writer that studied Lefebvre, Castells, and Michel de Certeau studied deeply. So my final hypothesis is that, which is just a working hypothesis, is that whenever the structure of the entire economy and society is crossing a crisis, the city is radically changing. At the beginning of Industrial Revolution, passing from the manufacturing system to the factory system, when the Taylor Ford labor organization took a place, and at its end, and finally at the beginning of the era that Bauman is calling the liquid society, Beck, Ulrich Beck, the risk society, Rifkin, the age of access. In other words, the urban question emerges when, as today, when the society is changing, when the economy is changing, when the space that they are using is changing, and when some scenarios, some more than some project, partially contrasting, if not conflicting, one against the other, emerges. Aware of these possible radical changes, many governments in Europe asked some teams, composed by experts of different disciplines, to study and propose a vision for their metropolis and their main city. The missions were always mission in research and design, assuming what for me is very important, that the design is a tool for improving our knowledge of different situations. I insist on this. The design is not the application of our knowledge, it's a tool to increase our knowledge. In my life, what I understood about the city, what I understood about different situations, is coming out from my activity of design, my activity to propose some project, to have some reaction, to have many critics, obviously, and to think about this, and to improve my mind, and to understand what I didn't know, what I have to know, where I can go with my researches, and so on. For instance, in France, in Paris, they were asking to study a vision for the metropolis of 21st century after Kyoto. That was a very good thing. And then, which is the vision, and I will clarify what I mean by vision, which is the vision of a long term, a century, but after Kyoto. Then taking account of environmental problems. In Moscow, they were asking to think to an expansion. Moscow, Paris has now 11.5 million people. Moscow the same. And in Moscow, they were asking us to think of an expansion of the city of Moscow for 2.5 million people. 2.5 million people in expansion, a project for 2.5 million, it's like to design Milano, to design Brussels, where to put all the main institutions, federal government, Duma, that is a parliament, there are two parliaments in Russia, national federal parliament and national parliament of the different nations, the main universities, the many hospitals and so on. Then it was a very extraordinary opportunity. How to think a new city where to put the main institution of the country. And in Brussels, in the middle, they asked to afford and to solve, if possible, the dual character of the city. Brussels I like Brussels, but it's very typical city where the topography was transformed in a topology. I mean, where the site have a meaning. So the rich people are living on the hills, on the top, and poor people in the valley. And this is very, very clearly. Also in Paris, there is something like that, and everywhere. But in Brussels, you perceive immediately that the rich are on one side, poor on the other side. And so they asked us to during the century, to transform this situation, this dual situation. And what does it mean to build a vision? Because I have to say that when they invited us in Paris, when they invited us in Moscow, in Moscow, I have to say, Moscow was a very exciting adventure. also because it's difficult to speak in a plain way with a politician in Moscow. Not to say more, but it's a very difficult job. When you have this kind of people with a visage that is expressing nothing, and you have to explain them your vision, is very difficult to do. It's difficult on the human ground, but it was very, very, very exciting. And what is meaning to produce a vision? For me, to build a vision means to think to the long term, that's the possible consequences of our action, immediate action, of today action on the long term. To build scenarios, not forecast. I joined I don't repeat what I told about the forecast, that are very difficult, especially if they concern the future, but to build scenarios in the form, what if? If you do that, the consequences could be that. If you do that on other things, so the consequences, and to compare this, and to push the people to reflect about and it's a very difficult job, because you cannot stay on some verbal reflection. You have to say, if you do that, without any probability, this will happen, or this could happen. And to build scenarios, to take an account that this scenario have not only to do with economic aspects, but that they have to do also with the physical aspect of the city. Our job is to study the physical aspect of the city. But you cannot forget that many things at political level, institutional level, cultural level are very important. And so in a period like this, where all the countries are facing a crisis that is not the financial crisis, that is, in Europe you perceive this, and in the US also, perceive this, Brazil is a fast growing economy, so it's different for the moment. Excuse me. But in Europe you perceive immediately that is a total crisis, and that it will last for some years. I hope the less possible number of years, but I'm not sure that in 10 years we will get out of this crisis. 10 years from now. Because there is a crisis of the representative system, because there is a crisis of the institution, all the institutions that were conceived in a different architecture of the state, if you want. There is a crisis of the welfare state that was conceived for a different society. There is a crisis in the personal relationship between the individuals, and so on and so on. Sociologists are telling many things about this. But what is interesting is that when you walk and walk in a metropolis like Paris, then you perceive this problem in a different way, in a less metaphysical way, in a very concrete way. In fact, when we started to study Paris, we had many methodological problems. How to know this metropolis? We discovered it very immediately. We discovered that all the people we were talking with, the minister, the president of the republic that then was Sarkozy, and the minister, the bureaucrats, and also our colleagues, they didn't know the big Paris. They were knowing Paris. But Paris is no problem. Paris is a wonderful city, no problem. The problem is outside Paris. The 11.5 million that are living outside Paris. And so I don't know if we were right or not, but we started to use what the mining engineers are doing. They know that there is something, but they don't know where exactly. And so they do what, I don't know if, you attack. That is many sections in order to understand how. And this was for Paris was a very useful system to know Paris. But obviously, we did also a very great field work. That is just a photo, but this is a photo that I like very much. Why? Because he's an Armenian, and he told me for some hours his history. That is an incredible history of one of me. And I perceived that people are living not in the same historical trajectory. I mean, he is inside a trajectory, an historical trajectory that is different of my trajectory, and from the, and that is something that that is producing a situation in which people cannot have a contact, cannot discuss together the same. So we had many adventures of this kind in Paris. I have not the time to show you everything. And finally, we built this map. This map, in red you have the pools. And the more intensive it's red, the more poor are they. In black they are the rich. And again, more intensive is the black, the more rich. And you see that there is a traditional image in Paris that the northeast is poor and southwest is rich, but the situation is more complicated. It's more complicated. There is a a kind of kaleidoscope in this city, with a different situation, different contacts between the different situations. And starting from this map, we built this one that we called Lucifer map. That the idea was that Lucifer was coming to us and asking to prepare a map of his properties, and this is the map. I have to say again, I think that many research have a political effect very important. When I showed this to Mr. Sarkozy, Mr. Sarkozy told me, "Secchi, you are completely crazy. It's not like this." And I told, wait. In some months you will have your census and you will see. And after this, it became an official map in Paris. To say that our field work was a discover where you are living in effect, but exactly where, not the to say there are part of the city in which the life is infernal, let's say. And starting from that, we proposed some strategies. And I have not the time to explain them, but the main strategies were about water, because Paris is a flooding area, and if there is the flood, something like 3 million of people are in the water, and that is a political problem. It's not only a physical problem. And energy strategy. We insist very much about this. How to save energy, how to consume less energy, how to produce energy, and which kind of devices we have to use. And mobility strategy. And the mobility strategy was perceived as the strongest one. It is not the strongest one. We told clearly, you have to get out from the engineer solution of the mobility. That is to build new highways, to build new metros, and so on. You have to think that the city is something different. Now I try to explain. The first problem you have to afford is to give a special structure to the city. Paris is conceived by all the French people, is conceived as a radio concentric city. There is a center, the first round, the second round, and so on. And this form is not, it's impossible that you don't have a congestion with this form. Everybody has to go to the center to go on the other side of the city. So we propose to get out from this form. I insist on the form of the city, not because I'm an architect, because the city is something, is a physical thing. And he has to function in a correct way. And as when I use this object or this, this it's the grade of all the functionalism, but we have not to push away everything. And the city has to function. In particular, the problem in Paris is now to build 700 apartments each year. No, excuse me, 70,000 apartments each year. And the question was for us was, and how do you distribute this apartment in the metropolis? like the cheese on the risotto, you know, or you use a strategy. And what we are proposing is a strategy in order to concentrate along some lines the main part of this. And we studied in detail these three theses inside the metropolis, and now we are concentrating on the more difficult part of the metropolis, where there were the riots in 2005, as you know. That I have to say, we worked in this part of Paris many times, and always with shame, because it's impossible that we do something like that. You walk 1 hour, 2 hours, and you don't find a white people, and you don't find somebody that is a middle class, lower middle class. No, you find only poor, only different situation. And in this part of there are many projects that are dispersed, completely dispersed, along the logic that to solve the problems. A logic that we cannot discard, because it's a logic of the problems that people and administrators will see. And so we propose to think to an horizontal metropolis. We call it this horizontal metropolis. What is the meaning of this? The meaning is that we have to get out from the idea that the power is the center and the periphery is something depends from the center. For us, the horizontality is the image of democracy. Horizontality, isotropy, is the image of democracy, and on the contrary, radio concentric city is the image of the strong power of the king in the past, and of Paris. So we are working on the mobility, saying, yeah, there are many lines that, like TGV, that have to cross Paris, and so on. But the other lines that are the metro and the buses and the tramways have to be isotropic. They have to irrigate the metropolis in a continuous way, with a network that is a very meshing the metropolis. And now we are working on this. There is a big polemics about this, I have to say, and a polemic in which we will not win, that is for sure. We proposed this as a surface public transport, tramway, mainly tramway. And the minister of the city proposed, on the contrary, a new metro that is called the Grand Paris Express. The cost, when he proposed, the cost of the new metro is the double of the cost of this network of water. And the time necessary to realize this metro is 1.5 the time necessary to realize. That 5 years ago. Now the cost of the metro double. So it's 4 times the cost of the network of tramways. And the metro is for 2050. But the problems are now, not in 2050, and we cannot wait a generation to solve a problem like this. So there is a big polemics. Maybe we don't win, but What do we told in Moscow with these people that was on the other side of the table, like statues? We told that there was periods in which a society expressed its main values in the city, in the physical aspect of the city. There were many periods in which this happened. Also in São Paulo, that I know better than Rio, but I think. But in Europe, this is evident. So if you want to displace all the main institutions in the new part of the city, and at this period were called usually city magnificence, magnificence of the city. If you want, you have to think of this, which kind of value you want to express. You want to be a democratic society, they want to be a democratic society, you have to express the values of democracy in this. And so you have to start, that is a very historical opportunity, you have to start from environmental problems. Moscow, I will show you, as a structure of spaces, natural spaces, that is incredibly rich and incredibly interesting. And you have to think an addition, like in Renaissance, an addition of the city, compact, not dispersed, that is organized, that is organized by a grid, in order, and that this. And what we proposed was an addition. And not to have satellite cities, they did this experiment and was a failure, not to disperse the expansion in the different direction, but to have a clear addition in which they want to represent the new society, the new Russian society. That is an interesting society. You know, there are many things that are very bad in Russia, but the society is something different from the new rich people. But what we proposed also is at the center of this addition, of this new expansion, to have a void, not the big, a void that is a park that has the same dimension of the park that in 35 was built by Semenov, the urbanist of Moscow, in this piece. And this park, and you see, the idea to put the main new institution. Why? The main new institution, like Moscow. I have to say, and Stalin, during his period, built what they call the Seven Sisters. That is the skyscrapers, at the time they were the highest skyscraper in the world, in which were put the different minister. And they organized the space of Moscow. And so we were saying you have to do in different way the same idea, and to that is normal for an urbanist, is a land use system. This is the Kremlin. This is the Kremlin. This is the expansion. And. To go, and so we proposed some concept in Moscow, first to be careful of environmental structure. From environmental point of view, the Moscow is a wonderful city, but where they built in a very in recent year in a very horrible way, and should take an account of the natural structure to mesh the city with a again a network a very and to give to think to continuous centralities. There is an idea today in Europe that is to design a multipolar city. For me, I don't know a multipolar city in Europe, nor in US. On the contrary, what is the history of the city in Europe is a continuous centrality. Centrality is along the strip, if you want, that is going out, that is going inside, and so on. And they are concepts difficult to accept, but I'm optimist because step by step this is the way the site where we put the central government with us. And one of the problems in Moscow is to give a variety of typologies for the living spaces, because they have this uniformity of typological uniformity that is oppressive. And I apologize. I would like, and that is what I told before, the Northwestern metropolitan area. That is a metropolis. This is Paris. This is London. Lille is here. Brussels is here. Antwerp is there. Rotterdam, Köln, and so on. And it's an extraordinary. I suspect that this will be the icon of 21st century. But I'm not sure of this. Is a scenario that is not a forecast. And again, we started with in Belgium there is a very dense network of public transport. Why? Because at the beginning of 20th century, 5 minutes, no more than 5 minutes. At the beginning of 20th century, there was a very strong debate in the parliament, the Belgian parliament. And they told them, be attentive, not to do the same as in London, not today to do the same as in Paris. Not to concentrate the proletarian people in the capital. We have to build a country where it's possible to live everywhere and to work everywhere. And so they developed a very dense network of public transport. And this is an opportunity that is unique in Europe. So we proposed what? We proposed a no-car scenario. What if we put away the cars from Brussels and the Brussels regions? Again, when I proposed this, Mr. Piquet, that was the ministry, told Bernardo, you are completely crazy. But after that, the agency for the public transport, the agency for the train, and so on, told, it's not so crazy. If we do this step by step, we start from some island that are pedestrian, that are yet there. And all the cities have some island, pedestrian island. And after we expanded them in order to join them, and after we reach a situation, but I'm not interested to have a city with no car. I'm interested to have a city with less car, less. And to do that, do you know how much space we can recover? how much public spaces we can design if we do that. And this was convincing, and that is a strategy to go there. And with some images like this, because I insist, to prepare a vision is not only to reflect the broader scale, is to cross the scales, to go to the detail. We convinced many associations of citizens to organize some weekend without car. They organized, they succeeded, it was a success. The municipality told, go on, try to do, and now in Brussels there is this movement to avoid the cars from some streets, from some street. And I think the process I illustrated there. Then for me, what is the meaning of what I told? Obviously, when I say no car, there is immediately a reaction. No, my car, you don't touch my car. Eh? Yeah, but that is, for me, the ideas are going on. And so maybe in 20 years we will meet again and we will say, Bernardo, you are right, the ideas are going on. And for me, it's not interesting, the idea of London, to oblige people, if they want a car, to pay more, to pay to enter in the center. No, the car is something, is a public good. So, but to do something, practically, to design public spaces, in a way that we don't need a car. And that is my final observation. If we compare the public spaces we designed in this last century, the 20th century, and especially in the second part of the 20th century, and we compare these spaces with the spaces, the public spaces we designed, we, as architect and urbanist, we designed it in the century before, the comparison is not in favor of us. The comparison is a very troubling comparison. So we have to insist the public space, the policy of public space is what is necessary today to solve all the three themes that I mentioned, environmental problems, mobility problem, and inequality problems. I thank you.
Temos aqui duas perguntas, eu vou começar com a primeira delas então. Não veio identificada, mas diz. Professor Secchi, o senhor começou a sua fala dizendo que o seu fazer só lida com problemas que pode resolver. Como então propor projetos quando as instituições não têm um entendimento político comum? Como construir, propor situações, hipótese de projeto, onde o projeto tem suporte frágil ou inexistente da política?
For what concerning to be in contact with me, if you have a pencil, write my email address. It's very, very easy. bernardo.secchi@secchi-vigano. That is the name of .it. All the project, I didn't show my project, it's a too long history. But all my project have a political commitment. And all my project were mission made by some political body. I don't work since 20, 25 years I don't work in Italy, because in Italy it is impossible to work. No, I'm very severe with my country. There is too much corruption in the public works
sector, there is too much speculation in the real estate sector, and I don't like for this. So Europe is big enough for me, so I work in Europe and not in Italy. And secondly, I never work for private companies. I work only for the public administrations. If you want somebody to say that this is an ideological choice, maybe. But as I'm interested in improving the way of life of people, and as I think that this is a main issue for a public administration, I think that my job, my role, is to help the public administration to do that. And a public administration for me is a public administration. I mean that Moscow with Medvedev and Putin is a public administration for me. It's not, I don't like too much them, but it's a public administration. Like my city, which there is a fantastic mayor that is by Pisapia. So I work only for the public administration. And working with this, I know that that today, for the, especially during the crisis, for a public administrator, it's very difficult to think to invest in the public spaces. Because they have no money, because the budget is always a problem, but I think that this is not a problem of the major, it's a national problem, European problem. What is astonishing for me is that in the last campaigns for the elections, both in Italy recently, very recently, both in Italy and in France, and in Belgium, no mention of the city problems, no mention of the three problems that I was telling you, and you were telling me, because practically you were saying the same, that environmental problems, mobility problems, and inequality problems are the main issues today everywhere in the world. No mention. And that is astonishing for me, because there is a gap between the society on one side with these needs, and the idea that the crisis is only and financial, the main policy is the economic policy and so on. That is, I hope no, but that is pushing us towards a disaster. I'm not sure of what I'm saying. I'm never sure of what I'm saying, but I think.
Professor Secchi, a nossa próxima pergunta.
This light, I don't see who is speaking.
Podemos então pedir do nosso palestrante apagar essa luz em retorno da filmagem? Obrigada. Is it better now? Nossa próxima pergunta, então, vem de uma participante que nos assiste pela internet, de Porto, em Portugal, é Helena Amaro. So, once again, Professor Secchi, this next question comes from Helena Amaro, from Porto, Portugal. She's watching us through the internet. Em português, a pergunta dela. O senhor acha que resolver a conflitualidade social que vem por aí, principalmente na Europa, passa por garantir a horizontalidade da cidade, ou seja, o acesso democrático a ela? Como acha que este acesso democrático pode se dar?
My idea is that we have not to see only the conflict. Because of the I don't know if you want to listen to me or not. Last month I was in a seminar in New York, in Parsons Schools, and the students are there, the Occupy Wall Street and the different movement, were thinking that the role, their role was to go in the neighborhood and to help the different associations that are doing this kind of protest, like Occupy Wall Street and so on. I was disappointed because for me it was something that I saw many years ago, a déjà vu, let's say. When I was impressed by the gesture before, the physical gesture. When I was young, I was in Berkeley at the time of a free speech movement, and I was impressed because it was something like a gesture. You had a chair there, but you have to sit down on the pavement. You have, and you know, somebody is sufficiently aged to see that you needed to have that. And first, I was impressed by this. I understand, but secondly, I was thinking that I saw this at the beginning of the 70s in France, end of the 60s in France and in Italy, and that was something that produced practically nothing. In Italy, produced the opposite of the desires of these young people. In France, less, but more or less. And so I was a little bit preoccupied of this kind of. But finally, I have to say that thank you to this movement, the world is changing. You remember people that is aged like me, maybe remember the first woman that in USA, Virginia, refused to go in the places, in the bus, in the places reserved to the Negroes. And she seated where. And you remember this, you know, anyway. And that was a story that started from there and was changing the world. And many of these stories were changing the world. So I'm severe, but on the same time, I have to recognize that this kind of conflicts are changing, not immediately, but in a middle term period, they are changing the world. But my role is different. My role is not to go in Wall Street and with Occupy Wall Street. I'm too aged. I'm not able to do that. My role is to think what I can do to this. Then, for instance, I can do many things that are working in the same direction. For instance, starting from the end of 19th century, we were thinking that to build social housing was good. And the welfare state was based this. And we didn't perceive that in many cases the neighborhood of social housing became a kind of ghettos, a kind of a policy that is separating poor people from the other people. And this is something that is troubling me because it's difficult to to build social housing dispersed in the city. It's very difficult from an operational point of view. But I think that we have to do experiment in this direction. For instance, in Rennes, Rennes is a city in northeast, northwest of the France, a city, a medium-sized city, to 200,000 people. We built a part of this city, and we imposed that the houses are built. And after we know that the 30% of these houses will be social, but we don't decide which are the social housing and which are not social housing. When they are built, we put the different families, families that have a right to be in social housing, dispersed in this neighborhood. That's it. I don't know, it's an experiment that we are doing. But for me, is in the history of architecture of the 20th century, to do houses that are less, obviously the houses of the poor are different from the houses of the rich, but less different than are the revenues of the rich of the poor. Do you understand what I'm saying? The distance that there is between a house, a social house, and the house of the rich people, the distance is less than the distance among the revenues of the different. And this was a research that the architect did during the period of social of welfare state. Now we have to think a different welfare state, because social housing in Europe, almost in Europe, was thinking always for a family of two parents and a daughter and a son or something like that. Now it is not like this. Now less than 50% of families are like this. In Italy, a true Catholic country, and the other more than 50% are or what we call free union, or the union of the same gender, of single, many single, and so on. So we have to think that the way in which population is using the stock of apartments is different of what we were thinking 30 years ago, 40 years ago. That is it's an important problem. But we have not stopped me, we have not to think that the solution is to share the space. That solution that is called Komunalka in Russia, and that is a long history. And usually, also last week in Paris, somebody was proposing an example of a shared space. He was a journalist, she was a model, a mannequin, a model. Thank you. In this case, it's very easy to share the space. To share the space when the family is a family of immigrants is much more difficult. So there is a research to do. And I think that sociologists can help us. If they do their job.
Bem, professor Sec, foram essas perguntas que podemos atender aqui em função do tempo, as demais serão encaminhadas a ele, se identificadas serão atendidas. E agora nós gostaríamos então de pedir ao professor Sec que aceite os nossos agradecimentos por todo o conteúdo que nos trouxe, por sua participação, por ter abrilhantado o nosso evento. Muito obrigada em nome de todos.